You're the resurrection that we've waited for. You buried the night and came with the morning. You're the King of heaven, the praise is yours. The longer the quiet, the louder the chorus soars. Song, he's dead and gone with the winter. We will sing a new song, let hallelujahs flow like a river. We're coming back to life, reaching toward the light. Your love is like springtime. You're the living water, God, we thirst for you. The dry and the barren will flower and bloom. You're the sun that's shining, you restore my soul. The deeper you call us, oh, the deeper we'll go. We will sing a new song. Come tend the soil of my soul, and like a garden, and like a garden I will grow, I will grow. Come tend the soil, come tend the soil of my soul. Like a garden, and like a garden, I will grow. I will grow. I will grow. I will grow.
Good morning, Capstone. So glad to have you all here worshiping with us today. Today we're continuing in our Kingdom Economics series, talking about finances in the Kingdom of God. I know sometimes talking about money openly is kind of uncomfortable, but it is such an important thing to talk about in God's kingdom. It's such an important thing to be able to address and know what Jesus says about it instead of just listening to what the world says. So I'm excited to learn more about that today and just gather together and worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So if y'all would go ahead and stand up with us and join us in a time of worship through song.
Is a mountain, you see a mountain move. love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible.
We serve a God who fights the battles for us and on our behalf, and that he doesn't ask or require anything from us, but lets us relish in that victory. Let's just continue this time of worship.
Table that you prepared for me. How do you
make decisions
differently with money?
Because of Jesus. Well, we are Pete and Connie Roll. We moved to Fountain Inn from a little place in New York called Arcade. July of 21, and we found Capstone in August, and we've been coming here ever since. It'll be 2 years in August.
About 6 years ago, I had a conversation with an older gentleman at our home church in New York. We were discussing tithing 10% versus tithing sacrificially. I walked away from that conversation feeling like Pete and I were shortchanging God. We discussed it, we prayed about it, and we agreed that we needed to stop pinching pennies and start listening to the Holy Spirit to give sacrificially. Stepping out in faith and giving up that kind of control was extremely scary, but I am glad that we were obedient to the Holy Spirit. Over the past 4 years, Jesus has been amazing. He has revealed himself to us through situations that were beyond our control. Jesus took charge He calmed fears, opened doors, and solved problems that we could have never solved ourselves. I'm reminded of scripture from Jeremiah 29:11 that says, "For I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." God is so good.
All right. Well, good morning. My name is Walt Tanner, the pastor here at Capstone. So glad you guys are here with us. Hanging out as we continue this Kingdom Economic Series. So this series we talked about last week when we started it is not the idea that we want something from you. So we're not asking to double our budget. We're not asking for more money for the expansion. This is really a discipleship series that really is about wanting something for you. Not wanting something from you, because there are a lot of people, and you might be here, or you might be watching online with the idea that, well, the church just talks about money too much, or they just want my money. That's not what we're trying to do. So we really want you to hear this, that this is something that we don't want to be discipled by the world to tell us how money should control us, but how do we control our money? So last week we looked at Matthew 6, which has a lot to say about money and providing and trusting God. And we said, and Jesus specifically says, look, you can't have two masters. You can either love one and you will hate the other. So you will either love God and hate money, or you will hate God and love money. And so we really began to look at the understanding we can't be mastered by our money, but mastered by our Creator. So remember, creation or Creator. What will we choose? What will be our master? So here was rule one. Rule one of Kingdom Economics is leave margin. Leave margin. We said that 60% of Americans, 60%, more than half, live paycheck to paycheck. And we said last week that some of you are relieved to know that you weren't alone. Others, you were shocked by that. But that's a true fact, and that's a stat from the end of last year. So the idea is that they don't have any extra money at the end of the month. There's no extra money to tithe. There's no extra money to give. There's no extra money to save. Even as you heard from the rules, no money to even give sacrificially. So even sometimes we tithe, and we talked about that 10%, and sometimes it's a little bit more, sometimes it's a little bit less, but the idea that we are providing for the Lord in that. And so as we talk about that, they understand that we're not mastered by money. We're not handcuffed to our desk. We're not working for our wants, but the idea of what does it mean to be serving the Lord and how we do that. And so God, again, God doesn't want our money to be a liability. God wants our money and our resources to be an asset that we use for freedom. Money isn't something that we should be hand tied to, but the idea that we have money and we are smart with it so that we can, again, just not want our wants, but the idea that we can move forward. So money isn't to control us, but we control it. Again, not to build our own kingdom, but to bring His. Money is not the idea that we are building our own kingdom, but it is the idea that we are building His kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. So we heard last week the idea of the 10-10-80 formula, the idea that we give 10%, that we save 10%, and we live off of 80%. Again, not paycheck to paycheck, but the idea that we are only living off 80%, and we confess. We say, look, many of us are living under the consumption assumption, which means we consume everything that we make. The consumption assumption. The world tells us, hey, you make it, go spend it. You earned it, it's yours. And so we don't leave any margin, and we don't understand what it really looks like. Again, not to look normal. Remember, as Christ followers, if you're not a Christ follower, glad you're here. But one of the things we say is as a Christ follower, you shouldn't look normal. Your life should look different because of Jesus. And you heard it up there. A disciple is someone who's pursuing Christ and making decisions differently because of Christ, especially in our finances. So we should be not normally minded, but kingdom minded. How are we kingdom minded? So here's another normal stat for you. You see it up on the stage, up on the screen. It says this, is that 39% of Americans only have $5,000 or less in savings. And that's more on the less, by the way. So again, less than half. 45% of Americans don't even have $1,000 in savings for emergencies. And 60% of Americans don't have a retirement account. Again, it's the same issue as last week, that people are spending everything that they're making. They're not able to have, quote-unquote, savings, so they're living paycheck to paycheck. So again, they're fulfilling their desires. They lack the discipline to begin to save, and that they've been mastered by our money is what this shows us if we're living normal. And so you're like, well, I'm living paycheck to paycheck. I don't really know how to do this. I don't understand what it looks like. I can barely pay my bills now. There's no way I can save any money. There's no way I can do any of that. And so we're going to go into our kingdom principle, which is number two, which is less is more. Less is more. So again, the idea that the reason why so many people struggle is because they choose not to say no. They lack discipline. They lack the discipline of being able to say, hey, you know what? I don't need that upgrade. Or the idea that, look, I see it, therefore I'm going to buy it. I need to drive that car. I need to live in that neighborhood. I need the additional square footage. I need more clothes for my closet. Or I need more purses. Or I need more shoes. I need that truck for my garage. Or I need that new tool. Or I need that upgrade. I need that toy. I need these things. And so because we lack the discipline of able to say that, then we think more is what's going to bring us happiness. We think more is what is going to complete us. We think more is what is going to make us happy in the end. But there's going to come down to this word, and this is where we're going to sit. It's the idea of contentment. What does it look like to be content with what we have? The world says you shouldn't be. The world says, hey, it's upgrade time. The world says you need more. You need a bigger TV. You need more of the things that you think, quote unquote, make you happy. Now, please don't hear me. Please don't hear me say, hey, you should never upgrade. You should never get new furniture. You should never buy new clothes. You should never get another car. Please don't hear me say that, because I have done all of them. What we're going to talk about is being content with what we have, being satisfied, simplicity, but understanding the order in which things should be, the idea of order. So again, that we have self-control. We have the discipline to say no. And it may be for now. It may not be forever that we would say no now, but it helps us in the end. So here's the question. How can we be okay with the idea less is more? How can we be okay with the idea that we're going to spend differently and we're going to focus on not what we get, but our focus is now beginning to think about what we can give? So many years ago, Betsy and I were a dink. Does everybody know what dink is? Double income, no kids, a.k.a. the glory years. Amen? All right? So we had a double income. We had no kids. And so we were living life on the anyway, we'll go different. But the idea that we came to a crossroads, so we have this double income. Last week I kind of told you guys that both of our families really instilled in us these kingdom economics. So even when we were dinks, we were trying to live, we were actually living on one income and we were saving the other income because we didn't know what God wanted to do. So we came to a crossroads, and this is a verse that that I heard and applied even then, so almost 20 years ago. It says this in Proverbs 30. Two things I ask. I ask for you, deny them not before I die. Before, remove far from me falsehood and lying. Give me neither poverty nor riches. Feed me with the food that is needful for me, lest I be full and deny you and say, who is the Lord? Or lest I be poor and steal and profane the name of the Lord. So we see the wisdom of being content. The idea that I don't want to be so poor that I have to steal, breaking God's command. But also, I pray that I'm not so rich that I'm not dependent and forget the Lord, which is also breaking a command. So basically, it's the idea of how can I be content with what we have, being content with who we are. Now, in America, it's more of the latter than the first. It's not the idea that we're so poor that we have to steal, but it's that we have so much that we forget and we don't depend on the Lord. So again, for my family, because I always want to tell you, this isn't something that I haven't wrestled with. This isn't something that journey I haven't gone down. So for us, when we were at that crossroad, we came to this question of, you know, what are we supposed to do with this resources? What are we supposed to do with what God's blessed us with? How can we be a good steward? And so for us, we began to ask, what are we dependent on for God? So Betsy and I, we were given the gift of being able to go to Israel and Turkey and being able to travel and be able to hear and see where Jesus taught and be able to go where Paul plants these churches. And we left that trip asking the question, man, what do we depend God for? And the answer was nothing. I worked for a very, very large church, over 1,000 people. We were one of the fastest growing churches in the nation and had a huge youth ministry, and I was getting paid plenty of money, and, you know, I was good. And Betsy had a cushy government job, and she was working for a judge, and he gave us tickets to the Masters, and we were able to live. I mean, we were doing great. And we really came down to the question of asking, man, if God didn't provide for us, what would change? And the answer was nothing. There was nothing that would change in our life if God stopped providing, because Betsy was still going to be working. I worked for a really, really big church, really, really successful church. It was, man, I was going to get paid, because there was no way that, man, what God was doing, it was great. I had a job, and it was great. So when Chris and Laura called and said, hey, we'd love for you guys to quit both of those cushy jobs, sell your house. Hey, we know you have a baby on the way, but would you consider moving to Fountain Inn to start a church? We were like, all right, well, here's our answer to prayer. How we're going to be dependent on God, and we're going to go from almost six figures to $1,000 a month. Let's see what God does. It was the biggest risk that we ever took because of Proverbs 30, where we begin to ask this question. Okay, God, we don't want to be so poor that we steal, but we also want to be not so rich that we can lean on you and see what you're going to do, that we would take be risk takers, and we would join this adventure. And so we did, and you guys are living a part of that obedience. That you're this big financial risk that we took almost 15 years ago, you guys are now in that, as we learned, and we had to be okay with less is more. We had to be okay with our retirements not being as big, that our house wouldn't be as big as square footage, that we wouldn't have, that we wouldn't be able to do some of the things that we had planned to do. We said, okay, you know what, God, you're worth it. So let's see what you can do when less is more. And we can tell you, man, God has done miraculous things. Just by the way, we never stopped tithing. We continue to have margin. We continue to do all the things. And we stepped out in faith and being content. All right, now let's look at Philippians 4. Now, many of us know Philippians 4:13. It's on the back of Steph Curry's shoes. It's on Luke Tanner's baseball glove. It's the idea that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And so we know that verse, but that context isn't you running suicides at basketball. It isn't you weightlifting press. The thing that he's talking about is finances, being content. So this is what he says in Philippians 4, verse 10. It says, I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at length you have you revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. You didn't have a way that you could help me. He said, not that I'm speaking of being in need, for I've learned in whatever situation I am to be content. In my Bible, that is highlighted. It is circled. I encourage you to do that as well. In all situations, I have learned to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound. In every circumstance, I have learned, we're going to talk about that, circle that, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger. I've learned about abundance and need, rich, poor, a lot, a little. He said, in all those things I can do all things through him who strengthens me. The strength that he's talking about is the idea of being content. And that's what he says, is I learned how to do these things, because being content, listen, being content is not natural. The world tells you you always need more. The world tells you the more things, the newer, the shinier, then that's where you're going to be complete. That's where you're going to be happy. What Paul says is, look, I've had a bunch and I've had little. And here's what I have learned, the strength that has given me to be content, whether I got a bunch or a lot, Jesus is what satisfies me, not my stuff. We as the church have, this is really, 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 really honest, we've kind of failed at that. We have failed at discipling this. We have failed at modeling this. We have failed with the idea that we need more things. And so he says, look, I've learned how to do hard things, the power to say no, the power to say no to comfort, the power to say no to things, the power for my scorecard not to be the things I get, but the things I give. The idea to say discipline so that I can bring the kingdom versus what can I get and build my own kingdom. The discipline to be able to say it's going to cost me something, to learn to be content. The scorecard wasn't building his kingdom, but bringing Jesus's. So here's the hard question. Here's our question. Do we have the discipline to do hard things and say no to some of the things that maybe drive us, that we feel like complete us, Can we have that discipline? Are we willing to sacrifice now? Can we build margin now? Can we collect savings now so that when God calls you to do something great, when God calls you to step out in faith, when God delivers you and says, hey, here's what I'm going to do when you step out in faith, that we can bear much kingdom fruit? Or will we keep living paycheck to paycheck? Will we look like normal people? Or will we begin to do something great for his kingdom? All right, one more scripture. Is 1 Timothy. So Paul again is talking to his disciple Timothy. He says, but goodness, godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world. And guess what? We can't take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content, whether a little or a lot. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. Now listen, that might be your story. Your finances have exactly what Paul has said, have plunged you into ruin and destruction. If it's not your story, you probably know someone who it is. That's their story because they chased after the temptation. They got caught in the trap of more. The idea that they weren't satisfied with what God had given them, so therefore they chased after more. For the love of money, here's that key verse, the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Why? Because the love of money will cause us to lie. The love of money will cause us to cheat. The love of money will cause us to keep back God and call ours versus his. So there's all kinds of evil that come from the love of money. It is through his craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pang. So again, here's this warning. First of all, the understanding that contentment is a Christ-like character. The understanding of wherever God calls you and whenever he calls you and understanding with what he's giving you is exactly what you need for that moment. And sometimes that's a little and sometimes that's a lot. Sometimes he gives you a blessing to see what you're going to do with it. Are you going to get tight-fisted with it and say it's mine? Are you going to say, hey, God, you've blessed me, so therefore I'm going to bless others? Sometimes we go and God may cause us to go through a hardship, and we may go through that valley. We may lose that deal, or we may not get that promotion, or we may, and God's go, all right, do you really trust me now? So wherever we're at, understanding that God has given us what to be content with and trusting him no matter whether it's a little or it's a lot. Again, we see lots of stories in our society and culture where he just described this idea of falling into the trap. We've seen many people fall away from the Lord. We've seen people chase after resources and things versus trusting in the Lord. So again, will we trust in our stuff or will we trust in our Savior? Will we be mastered by it or trust our master? And if you're here and you're like, well, I don't have a lot of bills. I don't have a lot of kids. I'm still in high school or middle school or college, or I'm just right now working for myself. If you learn this now, I promise you it will transform your future. Because what you do now and what you're continuing to begin to see and understand, if you can be content with a little now, you'll be content when you have a lot. So continue to understand that we need to think like kingdom people, living differently, being content with what we have. When we're content, listen, the pressure's removed. The pressure's removed from keeping up with the Joneses. The pressure is removed of having to stay handcuffed to that desk, to that job that brings you misery. The pressure is removed when we are content with wherever God has us, with what he's doing, specifically finances. It gives us freedom to be who God calls us to be. All right, two things that I think are going to be key if we're going to be content. The first is this, simplicity. Simplicity. We live in a complex world. We're told, hey, you just need this app. You just need another tool. You just need another gadget. That's what's going to make life better. So we build our lives around the complexity of life, and we continue to add more things and more apps, and the reality is it adds more stress. We begin to simplify our life. We begin to say, hey, is less really more? We need to ask the question of, do the things we really, quote unquote, want meet our basic needs? Because here's the truth. A lot of the things that we're spending, the wants that we're spending our money on, are keeping us from the things that we really need. Peace, rest, relationships, hope. Because we're working so hard to, quote unquote, provide for our wants, it's taking us away from our needs. It's taking us what God calls us, says, this is what you really, really need. Again, we've kind of started with the idea that we don't have savings. One of the biggest reasons we don't have savings is consumer debt. The reason we have consumer debt is because we feel like we need more things. So if we remove the things and we can remove the debt, we can maybe find simplicity. We can maybe find contentment. Because many of us are financing it, we're charging it, we're trying to impress people who don't really care. Simplicity begins to ask the question, hey, do I really need that? Or here's one tool that we used and I was taught is, can you pay cash for it? I can remember, I told my community group this last weekend, is that I can remember where I was standing in my grandmother's house. And she was giving me money for report cards, and she gave us $5 for A's, and you know, then on down. And I didn't get a lot of money, FYI. But she may have known that because she told me. She said, "Hey, Walt, here's something you need to know. Here's a Tanner rule: is that if you can't pay for it for cash, you can't afford it." She told me that, and I can remember where I was standing. I can remember her sitting on the couch. I can remember all of it. And it's one of the things that I've carried with me, the understanding that if I can't pay cash for it, then I can't afford it. And here's one of the things. It's amazing how content you can be when you don't finance things. It's amazing how content you can be when you have to save that money and it finally gets back to dish out that cash that you've been saving. And it took you months to save. You go, do I really want that? Or it might be going, you know what? I've had time to kind of save and I've realized I don't really think I need that. That's the thing in the power of when you begin to slow down, and cash slows you down, and you begin to kind of simplify things because you've stopped financing things that you really can't afford anyway, by the way. You begin to build margin in your life. You begin to build time where you're taking time, and your ability to say no in the moment has allowed you to build momentum. So the idea of simplicity and paying cash for things. The next thing is decluttering. So again, here's a rule that we have. If you haven't used it in a year, do you really need it? You begin to think about decluttering and like, well, do we really need a new house or do we just need to have a yard sale, right? We're having a yard sale May 4th. One of our community groups is raising money for New Day, one of the ministries in our city, and the idea of going, hey, how can we serve? And so you may have plenty of stuff and realize we haven't used it. And so we're going to declutter. We're going to bring it up here, and it's going to be, I told Jordan, everyone who's working it is going to have to dress like a Star Wars character because it's on May 4th. And so everybody's going to have to come, and there's going to be barbecue. You can just come buy some barbecue, and there's going to be great stuff here. But if you have junk that you don't need, you can bring it up here. Declutter, get rid of stuff. Simplify. One of the things, my youngest, I told you he's the one who likes to buy things. So he's always like, hey, Dad, let's sell stuff so I can go buy more stuff. And he's like, let's have yard sales. And one of the things at our house is we don't have a yard sale because if we don't use it, we get rid of it. We take it to Miracle Hill. We love their ministry. FYI, do you know how much Miracle Hill makes in their thrift stores? $10 million, all right? So to serve homelessness and foster families. So encourage you guys, if you can, go to Miracle Hill. But get rid of it. And so if we use it till it breaks or we don't need it anymore. And if not, then it doesn't stick around. It doesn't collect a lot of dust at our house. That's just one of our rules, one of our things. Because the understanding of when we simplify, we can give it away, and the understanding we can bless someone. And so again, you can help that. You can do a yard sale. You can bless. You can minister. You can give money to Haiti. You can do whatever you want to, but if you're not using it, simplify, and so that you understand less is more. Your identity is not in the stuff you've collected. That's not what it's meant to be. The next is this, satisfaction. You're satisfied with not what you have. You're satisfied not on the next big thing. And this is something that's old as time. The idea that King Solomon said, and he was a wise man who had everything you could ever imagine. He had the palaces, he had the women, he had the money, he had all the stuff. And in the end, he said, look, I'm never satisfied. I can't fill this void in me. It's like chasing after the wind. You will never capture it. So until we become satisfied with where we are and what we have, we will never catch it. So you need to begin to wrestle with your stuff. Is your stuff really what makes you happy? Is that what it is? Is that what you're chasing after? Or can you be satisfied with the little things? And you're like, well, Walt, you know, I only make like $40,000. And so, you know, we're living simple, you know, I've got to charge it because I don't make much money. Here's the thing. If you're not satisfied at $40,000, you'll never be satisfied when you make $140,000. Because it's not about, well, here's what money does. Money doesn't make you more generous. Money just amplifies what your heart already is. That's why people who win the lottery go broke. They're playing the lottery because they're not good with money. They win the lottery and they go bankrupt because they're not good with money. So don't think, hey, I will find satisfaction when I can afford more things. No, if you can't be satisfied with a little, you'll never be satisfied with a lot. And I know people who have six figures, seven figures, and they're satisfied not because they have a lot of stuff. They were satisfied when they didn't have anything. That's a heart issue. Not being satisfied in our stuff, and as Christ followers, that we be satisfied in Christ, in our Savior, no matter whether you got a clunker in the garage or you got a Beamer, which it doesn't matter. I pray that I don't have so much I have to steal. I pray that I don't have so much that I don't have to lean on you. If our satisfaction isn't found in Christ, we'll never be satisfied in the things that we have. So again, we think if I just get more stuff, retail therapy is a real thing, right? It's the idea of, man, I'm bored, I'm on commercials, let me go on Amazon and see what I can buy. I had a bad day, let me buy a new outfit. It's the idea that, man, I can just, if I get more things, I'll get that satisfaction of a new car, or I'll get that satisfaction of getting a bigger house. Then our family will be happy. Then our marriage will be easier. Then we'll be able to do all these things if I can just get what I, quote unquote, want. But what if you begin to think, man, what if I'm satisfied here? Now, that might be your story. You may never get a bigger house. You may never get a new car, but please don't hear me to say you can't get a bigger house or you can't get a new car. Again, it goes back into the order. It goes back into why. Are you upgrading because you feel like it'll make you complete? Why are you investing? Whose kingdom are you investing in? So again, I told you guys, you know, we bought a bigger house. So 8 years ago, we went Friday. Betsy and I went on a hike, getting ready for the men's hike. Couldn't go Saturday, so we went Friday, and we were just kind of talking about kind of our life and story. We realized we were about to be in our house, the longest we've ever been in a house in 18 years of marriage. But 8 years ago, we doubled our square footage from 12,000 square feet to 12,000. Wow, man. Y'all didn't know I lived in that big of a house. No wonder I'm talking about money. No. Not 12,000, 1,200 square feet to 2,400 square feet. And so we had come to a place where we had two boys and we had started fostering. And we began to kind of look at our future and where the church was going. We had community group at our house. We were having Edge at that time at our house. We were hosting leadership meetings. We were doing all these things in this little house. And we began to say, okay, God, are you calling us to something bigger? Are you calling us that we need to invest in your kingdom? Not because our status was going to be in the neighborhood we live in, not because we thought we needed it because we wanted to keep up with the Joneses, but we said, okay, God, this is for your kingdom. So we began to pray. And we began to budget and keeping margin. We kept giving money. We kept being radically generous. We kept doing all of that. And in our budget, we said, okay, if we want to move, here's what it's going to cost. And we just went ahead and built that into our mortgage payment. And we started paying extra on the house that we were living in. And so when we moved in, it was just a lateral move financially. We didn't have to scrimp. We didn't have to stop tithing. We didn't have to do any of that. Why? Because we just made a lateral move. Because we budgeted, we planned, we left margin to be able to do that. We were able to find this house, and we were able to find a fixer-upper, a foreclosure, which is what I love to do. And I'm in an 8-year current renovation, of continued renovation. But the idea that it's not mine, and the reason we've done it so we can host, and we've been able to, you know, foster over 12 boys. At one time, we had 5 kids living in our house, and there are holes in the wall, and there are marks on the things, and guess what? We love it. And it's not because of status, but it's because of calling. So what's God calling you to do? So again, it's the idea of maybe God might be calling you to downsize for that calling. God might be calling you to get a 15-passenger van because he wants you hauling kids all over the place. He might be calling you to be able to save so that you can go do that job, so that you can go and be with your kids more. It might be that God's calling you, but if financially, if we are handcuffed, if we are enslaved to bondage, then we will never be able to do what God calls us to do. And when you do invest, and when you do get that upgrade, when you do those things, not about what you get and your satisfaction, man, I finally made it because I have that Beamer. I finally made it because I got this house. I finally made it because I got that. No. God, you have provided for me, and you have blessed me, and I am using it for your kingdom. I am using it for your glory. Next week is all about live generously. So, again, less is more, live generously, leave margin, all else. Last week will be listen to others. But next week is live generously. Why? You have been blessed to bless others. God did not give it to you to bury it. He did not give it for you to build your kingdom. He gave it to you to invest in others. And when you are satisfied and when you live simply, you will have more to be generous with. That's next week. When you begin to have margin, you will have more, not for yourself, but for him. And here's what I have seen time and time again, and there are people in this room, by the way, who have given away more than I'll ever make. There are people who are in this city who have taught me more about finances and kingdom, and they have tons of money. It's not about whether you have a lot or a little. It's about your heart. And by the way, if you are here struggling, please don't be embarrassed. Please don't think you shouldn't talk to anyone. You are what we call normal. You're normal if you're in debt. You're normal if you're struggling. You are normal if you're living paycheck to paycheck. Please don't use this as an opportunity to go, man, I just don't want to talk about it because I'm embarrassed. No, this is why I'm talking about it now, because I want you to have these conversations. I want us to be able to help each other, because I believe God is calling Capstone to do something that will shock the world. But if we as Capstone family are handcuffed financially, then we can't do what God is calling us to do as a corporate body. And so when we begin to do that, and we can build houses for people, and we can build community group, community center, and we can build tiny homes, and we can start businesses, and we can start giving people jobs, not because we could come to church on Sunday, but because we have kingdom economic mentality. So don't hide because you're embarrassed by your resources, because you didn't have a grandmother on the couch who told you to pay cash for everything, or because you didn't come from a place. That's what community is for. That is what the church is for, is to help each other. So you can see me, you can see someone who brought you, you can talk to your community group about it, but please have those conversations so we talk about finances. All right, so here's our big idea. It's this, is kingdom economics rule number two, less is more. You've heard me say that already. But when we learn to be content in whatever we have, we are free from the bondage of more. Again, it's your priorities. Are you buying things in order to be complete? Or are you buying things because it helps you invest in the kingdom? Man, everything I have, and we heard a story about a family, their house burning down and everything being burned up, and people are talking about, you know, all the things they would lose. I'd be honest. I'd be happy because I could get new furniture. Like, oh, the house burned down, great. Now we can get rid of the one that my cat has destroyed and torn apart. Because most of our furniture is either used, or destroyed, or broken. And when people come over to our house, right, like, well, we don't want to break anything. I was like, if you break everything, we're out a few $1,000. It's okay. But the mentality of, there's nothing on this physical earth that I have that you can't have, that you can't use. Like, if you need my truck, just holler, you can use it. The idea that you got a pop-up camper, man, that thing's not great. But if you need it, you want to go with your family, take it. Because it's not mine, it's his. And so when we begin to think that I want more things for me, guys, like, you're missing the point of why I've given what I've given you. If your identity is in when you're stuff and not your savior, you missed it. But when we become content, when we begin to be satisfied with what we have, not what we want, when we begin to live simply, not because we need to stack more cash or because we need more things, but just to live simply. Again, that doesn't mean you live in a cardboard box. Doesn't mean you just ride your bike to work. But the idea of going, man, what is it like for you to live simply and not be identified with what you have, but who you have in Christ? Let's pray. Lord, man, the world has trapped so many of us, and 1 Timothy 6 has it exactly right. The world has led us to a place of destruction and ruin because of our money. And so, Lord, I pray and I confess, God, I'm not perfect. I try to lead by example. I try to say, hey, if it's mine, it's yours. It's the idea that, God, you have blessed me, so may I bless others. God, I pray if there's anyone here, first of all, who doesn't know you, they're just here checking out church. They're just here. I mean, I hear they would hear our heart. That you want something greater than them than just coming to church. You want something greater than them than just following rules. You want something greater for them in bringing the kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. That's what we're called to do. May we not just focus on building our kingdom, but may we be financially free and follow the kingdom economic rules so that we can bless others, so that we can bring your kingdom on earth as in heaven, so that we can continue to do what you call us to do. Not be in bondage to a master, but may we surrender to our master who is Christ. So God, may we follow the rules in this wisdom, Lord. May we be content in living simply and being satisfied in you and you alone. Man, everything else is the cherry on top. Everything else is a blessing. Everything else that we have on top of Christ is truly a gift. So God, may we not lose sight of that. May we not think money is ours. May we not think our home is ours. May we not think our stuff is ours. For I have been crucified with Christ, no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And so you have blessed me through Christ. God, I'm excited for what you're doing in and through Capstone, Lord. I believe that there is a wave of momentum, and I think it's just not about people, God, but I think it's about a movement that you are going to, we're going to be a light for so many different people. So, Lord, if someone here is struggling, I pray they would confess. God, if there is someone here who needs you, I pray that they would call out. God, I pray if there is someone who needs guidance, that they would seek it. So may we enter now into this time of worship, and may we worship you with all of our heart, soul, and mind. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. It is for freedom that we have been set free. Jesus died so that he could purchase our freedom. He could purchase our contentment in him so that he could purchase a life that we are able to use to follow him. If y'all would go ahead and stand up with me and join us in a time of worship through song, lifting the name of the Lord high.
Praise the one.
has paid it all. Thank you. gift of the cross in our lives. Hallelujah, that you are willing to sacrifice yourself for us, to pay for our debts that we alone owed, yet you took them on yourself and paid them to give us freedom, a life that is full of freedom, that we can set down our sin, that we can follow you in the ways that you have called us. We just praise you and thank you for who you are, everything you have done, everything you will continue to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, Capstone family. We'll get you out of here in just a few minutes. I just want to have a couple announcements. My name's Jake. I joked around earlier this morning that I'm Sarah's husband, but people said I'm more than that, and I appreciate it. But one of the things I want to talk about is our big idea for the day. Less is more. That resonates with me, and I think each time I sit through one of these sermons with Walt about money, I kind of come in with the thing, was, well, I know that. I don't need to, you know, then he says something. I'm like, oh, that was directed, you know, right at me. So we can all kind of take something away from this, and I really enjoy it. For those of you that are new here, maybe you've been coming for a while, we have a couple options if you want to learn a little bit more about the Capstone family. There is a tear-off on your message map on the bottom, and there's also a next steps little pamphlet in the seat back in front of you. And if you want to speak to someone in person, you can go to the bridge, which is in the lobby. There's some goods and stuff you can buy there and just actually talk to someone about anything that you may need to talk about. But that's it, and as always here at Capstone, we send you out as missionaries where you work, learn, live, and play. Have a good week, guys.